Right. Thank you very much. It's a shame because I was talking last night in the bar and I said, I've prepared the perfect opening line for tomorrow's presentation. I'm going to get on stage and say thank you both for being here. But actually, it's a pleasant turnout this early in the morning, so I'm pleasantly surprised. I was involved in a project. We actually started in 2012 with EuroPol, which is an umbrella organization for European law enforcement, like Interpol, but slightly more regional, and an organization called ICSPA. And it was a project called Project 2020, and the brief was to try to imagine the future of technology over what was then the next 8 years, and what the potential for exploit and the potential vulnerabilities in those technological advances would be. It was a hell of a challenge to take on in the security industry. As I'm sure many of you know, we're kind of used to working on a 12-month horizon. We tend to, at the end of every year, have our predictions for the next year, and the cycle repeats and the cycle repeats, which is a nice, comfortable place to be. So trying to work to an 8-year horizon was challenging, but ultimately very, very interesting. So what I want to present to you this morning in 20 minutes is to try and distill a 25-page white paper which came out of that whole process and was published towards the end of last year. That white paper itself can be downloaded from 2020.trendmicro.com. There's a whole load of cool stuff there which I'll explain later, but in the download section is the white paper itself, which I encourage you to read if you want to get more detail on what we talk about today. So, as I said, it was a joint effort. It was led by EuroPol. I contributed very much to the baselining part of the report to say, you know, where do we stand now? What does the threat landscape look like now? What are the current emerging technologies and trends? And then EuroPol went on to draw out three scenarios based on that, one for the individual, one for small business and enterprise, and one for nation states, about how technologies might change and what opportunities that would present. Now, this is not a single future which is being predicted. It's a possible future, of course. But what I found very interesting, and I think it will become apparent to you as we go through some of the conclusions, is that after we'd done the research and published the report, certain things began to happen, Snowden and other things, that began to bear out some of the predictions that we made in the document. And things that have been launched, for example, at the Consumer Electronics Show really are foreshadowing a lot of the stuff that we had imagined in the report. So when you look at some of this, you might think, no, this is way further off than 2020. But you've got to imagine that advancements in technology always continue to accelerate. Technological innovation never slows down. So actually, what's possible over the next, say, 8 years is probably what was possible over the previous 16 years, and so we go on. Considering the view from, the slide says the view from 2014, because I didn't want you to think I was giving you a very old presentation, but more accurately, it would say the view from 2012. So you may think there are a couple of things missing, but I think even in 2012, when we began the baselining procedure, things that are still a problem today were already apparent, such as, and here's a really timely example, attacks on SSL and TLS, if anyone's a Mac user in the audience, or an iPhone user. Those protocols were already considerably weakened by theoretical and practical attacks on them, uses of stolen rogue certificates, the development of cybercrime as a service, attacks on critical national infrastructure. We did our own experiment. We made a water treatment plant, honeypot, to see exactly, you know, there's a lot of hype about SCADA attacks and people interfering with CNI. What if we put a water treatment plant out there? Who's going to attack that and how and where from and how many? And we got some very surprising results, which is actually also available as a white paper on the Trend Micro site. People were attempting to log in. People were attempting to change configuration in ways that would have been physically damaging to the equipment from all around the globe, not just from one particular region. So this was the baselining operation that we did. And from that, we drew out these three scenarios. We tried to work out what the dependencies were between different technologies, between different institutions, different parts of society. We tried to identify what barriers would be there to further progress, what barriers there would be in society, what barriers there would be emotionally and mentally and technologically, and deliberately to focus on the criminal opportunities for criminal attackers, for activists, for hacktivists, for nation-state-sponsored activity, for all the stuff that we're familiar with today. I don't think the attacker themselves is going to change very much, but certainly their routes to market will change quite radically. So the first of the three scenarios was a young lady who we chose to call Kinuko, for no better reason than that was the name of a girl that the lady at Europol shared a room with when she was at university. So that's where Kinuko came from. She's 23 years old in 2020, so she's what we would call a second generation digital native. And the world for her is very different than the world for us. These were my visual aids to remember what I was going to talk about, and I looked at them this morning in a panic and went, I wonder what they mean. but I'm pretty sure I can remember all of them. So first of all, and Google Glass is definitely a foreshadowing of this, heads-up display has become absolutely ubiquitous. It may even be that by 2020, Google Glass has already miniaturized into Google Contact Lens. That's something that we imagined when we made the web series that I'm going to show you a little bit of later on. And we thought we were kind of really pushing the envelope a little bit there when we miniaturized a contact lens, maybe not by 2020. And then I was looking at the CES show this year, and I noticed something called iOptic, which is a product that was launched at CES. iOptic is a little contact lens which gives you superhuman vision. No word of a lie. So you can hold your finger this close to your eye and see every detail of your fingerprint, and at the same time focus on the far distance. And this is what the contact lens does for you. When you pair that contact lens with a pair of glasses, which are full with micro projectors, you end up with a giant canvas on which you can project information. So the heads-up display that you've seen with Google Glass, I think they said it was 20 times the canvas of what you get with Google Glass. They said Google Glass was like holding your iPhone out here, and it is, because I've worn one. It's like having an iPhone here. And iOptic was 20 times the size, like a canvas that fills your whole field of vision. So I don't think, actually, that the ubiquitous heads-up display is as far off as we think it is. We also predicted the rise of an industry called the content service provider, where, for the first time, we begin to experience the real world through the filter of the internet. So the internet is overlaid on everything that we do. And all of the content that's provided to each individual is tailored based on things they've already done, things they've already bought, places they've been, probably where they're going next based on past habits. And everything that they see and everything that's supplied to them is tailored around their personal experience. So for the first time in history, possibly the internet becomes a technology which is beginning to shrink our horizons rather than expand them. Because everything we see and do is based on something we've already seen and done. So one challenge will definitely be trying to re-engineer that element of serendipity back into our web experience. The example that I like to give, and this really ages me, is that you may be doing a school project on Rio de Janeiro. And so you go to a search engine, you type in Rio, and completely accidentally discover that marvelous album of the same name by Duran Duran. That's the serendipity that we currently experience when using the web. But if everything's based on preferences, profiles, experiences, and supply tailored to every individual, that kind of thing goes away. But there are advantages. So technology breaking national barriers, breaking boundaries, breaking linguistic boundaries. We have Kinuko online dating with someone who doesn't speak the same language as her, but there's instantaneous translation happening. This is not far-fetched either. With Google Glass already, you can look down at a word that's written in a foreign language and have the word in your own language superimposed over the top of it, so you can understand things that you're absolutely not able to understand. It's a world of sensors where information is being collected all the time, from car to garage, from your clothes in the gym. You look at some of the stuff again from CES, earbuds that measure your pulse and the amount that you're sweating, clothes for the gym that measure your general fitness, your respiration, your work rate. And all of this sensor technology is being aggregated, all of this data is being aggregated, and maybe it will lower your health insurance premiums, or maybe it will get you a discount in a sports store, but it's being aggregated and it's being shared. One of the things that I think really changes the world for the individual is the way that they interact with their work environment. And this is something which we saw also radically changing. Already, if you look at some surveys of individuals that are leaving school, leaving college right now, most of them expect to be starting their own business within the next 5 years. Now, I left university in... and no one that I knew was talking about starting their own business within the next 5 years. Most of the people I knew were talking about going to work for accounting firms. I don't know why, or being a teacher. It was one or the other. But nobody expected to start their own business. But that's really changed now. People expect to be able to have this world-beating idea, start their business, make their fortune, and off they go. And that's a great thing. I don't think it's always massively unrealistic. But what we thought would really change there and actually will facilitate that is that small businesses will no longer be groups of individuals working together in the same room as a team, but it will be more of a global cloud-based collective where people are pooling skills and knowledge. There will be very much a barter network of skills. There'll be less of a requirement on many people to hold down one single full-time job. Because you'll be working in various collectives. You might trade your ability to play guitar for someone else's ability to speak Spanish, for example, and build up skill sets that way, because it's all facilitated by technology. There's going to be innovation in the supply chain as a result of that. Many, for example, manufacturing companies will be sourcing components and raw materials from these cloud collectives. We've already seen what 3D printing has done to really begin to shift manufacturing environments. Imagine the advent of 4D printing. So 3D printing, where components are manufactured at various locations, they're self-assembling, self-locomoting, drawing power from their surroundings and routing instructions to get themselves to the right place, to assemble themselves into something meaningful. This is not a million miles away. We're already talking about buses on bus routes beginning to draw power from their bus routes and recharge themselves as they drive around. The same thing can certainly be said of smart components, but imagine the criminal opportunities for interfering in that supply chain process. We begin to see businesses being rated. Cyber insurance is already a relatively mature offering from many insurance companies. A lot of companies are not taking advantage of cyber insurance, but I know that a lot of insurers, because I talk to those companies directly at several events, have actively developed their cyber insurance offerings. Sometimes it's dependent on technology, sometimes it's dependent on some kind of shady tie-up with a particular technology provider, like if you buy this box, we'll give you cheaper insurance because they have a deal with the manufacturer. But those offerings are there. And one of the things that we thought is a running certainty for 2020 is something which we began to call the Security Score Initiative, where businesses and possibly even individuals are graded. They get a security score, and that helps you choose a business partner. If this organization is known to protect data better, to meet a certain level on the security score initiative, then they're more likely to be selected as a business partner. And they're going to get lower cyber insurance premiums. If they have a lower score, that's going to encourage their spending in the right areas of security to begin to move up the ladder. And that same initiative, I think, we also talked about it being applied on a nation state level to make your country, and we'll talk about the country of South Sylvania in a second, to make your country a more attractive place to do business. If you can have like a Moody's rating, where we rate countries on a financial perspective as to how safe they are to do business financially, how safe their debt is to invest in, their government debt, for example. We talked about the expansion of the universal security score on a nation-by-nation basis. All the businesses that we see, both in enterprise and in SMB, are increasingly reliant on the cloud. And I think, you know, if we move on, because I'm conscious of time, to the country, this was a fictitious country of South Sylvania that we invented purely for this exercise. But in South Sylvania, the critical national infrastructure is 100% in the private sector. Infrastructure itself is almost 100% cloud-based. There's government oversight over this third-party CNI. And in fact, the whole telecoms infrastructure has now become classified as critical national infrastructure because that's the backbone that everything else is delivered over. So we're no longer simply talking about water and electricity and drainage and sewage and transport mechanisms, but the whole telecoms and content service provision sector has fallen into this classification of critical national infrastructure because all of the government services have been turned into e-government. Everything is delivered electronically. South Sylvania as a country is one that invested very heavily in turning its economy around as they realized the rare earths that they depended on for their economy were depleting and they had to build a future. They invested heavily in their telecom sector, they invested heavily in their education sector and have become a center of excellence within Europe for technology, design, and innovation. But one of the things, and again, there's foreshadowing of this now, one of the other things that we predicted as a part of this exercise was the balkanization or the regionalization of the internet. And as I said, this was all pre-Snowden, and it's kind of strange to see that sort of activity bringing some of this to fruit. But we see Angela Merkel of Germany talking about working with the French government to create a separate European internet so that the traffic in Europe no longer has to flow over American cables and thus can't be intercepted. can't be intercepted, absolutely not. And of course, what are they going to do about the British? Because GCHQ in the UK were massive collaborative partners and continue to be collaborative partners of the NSA in terms of intelligence sharing. So are they going to begin to shut then the UK out of their European internet? And is that going to lead to further balkanization and breakup of infrastructure? And then international diplomacy and internet diplomacy begin to become one and the same thing. And then where you see countries, for example, like Russia beginning to restrict the gas supply to the Ukraine, what happens when we begin to restrict the internet supply to another country? Or because of supposed state-on-state activity, we begin to take more cases in front of the United Nations. But then the United Nations lacks the will and the expertise to do anything about any of these cyber incidents that are being brought to their attention. We actually envisaged the beginnings of an international cyber criminal court by 2020. And I was talking to a few people yesterday about whether they thought an international cyber criminal court was a viable proposition. And I didn't hear a single word of disagreement, to be honest, which surprised me. The other question about whether anybody thought it would actually be useful is a completely other subject, but that it would exist, I think people tended to agree on. So reaching the end of the document, what we tried to do was to work out lists of the kinds of opportunities, threats, activities that would become more apparent. Certainly one of the things that we thought would be widespread in consumer land was a market for scramblers of near-field communication, scramblers for things like mood recognition, anonymizing devices. You look at the kind of data that can be drawn out of even basic social networking technologies like Facebook, for example. Facebook is pretty sure they can guess without any explicit input from you, for example, your sexual orientation or your religious beliefs based on your activity on the social network. The more data that we collect from more sources, then things like mood recognition on a daily basis become simple. Highly distributed denial of service attacks. I mean, we already see, certainly with botnets, is already a highly distributed denial of service attack. But if you can move that, if everything has become cloud-based, and there is very little which is local and personal, then using the power of the cloud on a globally distributed basis is an order of magnitude or two worse than the current DDoS bandwidths that we're beginning to see. We see a mature market for illicit and counterfeit virtual items. This is the kind of thing we already see, certainly in Asian cultures with online gaming, and we've seen murders for the sake of virtual swords in Asian countries, so this is absolutely not too far-fetched. And as the critical national infrastructure becomes more connected, becomes more digital, obviously the potential for attacks on that infrastructure begins to grow. And I think, actually, although this was a project looking forward, one of the key things to consider is that it's not exclusively the new technologies that we need to worry about being connected to this Internet of Everything, this much vaunted Internet of Everything. One of the biggest worries that's often ignored is all of the legacy technologies that we're now beginning to connect to the Internet of Everything that were never designed to be connected in the first place. Not just, you know, the nuclear power plants that everyone's extremely paranoid about, but we did an exercise into the radio technology for guiding and directing ships and cargo recently. This was absolutely designed to be discrete radio-based technology, never to be connected. But now we have software radio. This stuff is eminently compromisable. You can redirect ships and read the cargo list and have your pirates waiting in the Gulf of Aden in exactly the right place. It's all entirely practical right now. There are others. Criminality becomes increasingly micro. As we as individuals begin to assert more control over our personal information and begin to receive micro payments every time our own information is processed by somebody else, instead of letting other people monetize our personal data, then criminality becomes increasingly micro. And the more micro individual activity is, the more difficult it becomes to detect, unless you have an overarching macro view of the movements of money on a wide scale. Cyber-enabled violence against individuals. Certainly, if we talk about taking over means of transport, if we talk about, if you're breaking into someone's perception of the world, that gives the possibility for all kinds of nefarious outcomes, from as simple as redirecting someone to something as complex as messing with someone's mind. If you're no longer hacking something that someone owns, but hacking something that someone sees, it becomes a very, very different thing. Sophisticated reputation manipulation. One of the big challenges is going to be managing multiple identities and switching between them online. If you can hijack someone's digital identity in a world where everything relies on digital identities, are you effectively really truly becoming that person? That was a big question for us to try and answer. There were many, many other questions to consider. Who owns that data? How long do they own it for? Who's going to distinguish between misuse and legitimate use? How do we make the difference between those? If you're dealing with a company that's selling aggregated data from sensors, which many companies will do quite legitimately, how are you going to be sure that that data hasn't been sourced in an illegitimate way and then sold through a front organization for a criminal company? Because criminal activity is becoming ever more a process of misusing legitimate technologies and processes in order to make money, and hidden at the back end is the criminal activity. Do we want local governance, local security solutions, local internet, or is it something that's better done at a regional level, at a United Nations level, at a European, at a North American level, whatever that may be? And how do we transition from what we see now to the world envisaged in this Project 2020 document, which I think is relatively unavoidable in many of its aspects, without causing global shocks to financial systems, without causing schisms between nations, between groups, and significant disruption and change within society? One of the things that we did, because what we're very good at, and I'm absolutely out of time, I can see that, but what we're very good at in the security community is talking to ourselves, talking to each other. And much as I love RSA, that's yet another example of the security industry speaking to itself. All the people that come here are already interested in this stuff. We came up with this great white paper, and we wanted to try and broaden the conversation to reach out to a wider audience, get people who don't even think about security or rarely think even about technology interested in the discussion. The people who are in education right now are the people who are going to be building, living, and inhabiting this world of tomorrow. So what we decided to do with this white paper was create a web series. It was 9 episodes long. Each episode was between 3 and 5 minutes. It finished, I think we put the last episode online in November, got a great response, but I wanted to give you a quick look at the trailer, which is just 1 minute of sample to see the kind of thing that we did, and we took the world imagined in the 2020 white paper and turned it, I hope, into something very compelling, which you'll enjoy and go and watch the rest of.
What's going on?
Getting reports of massive cyber attacks on critical networks. They're coming from everywhere. True augmented reality became a way of life for us here in South Slovenia.
We have forsaken the Lord and placed our faith in this instrument of evil.
The rise of the content service provider industry has meant that perfectly tailored information is available before you even know you need it.
There's no alternative to technological development. No matter what the risk, it's worth it.
The first entirely digital election in the world, and it is up to us to make it run smoothly.
We may have a problem.
Death toll has risen to 90 in what experts are calling the biggest cyber attack of the century, the Great Switch Off.
These elections are going to be our greatest achievement.
Incompetence is one thing. Willful ignorance is quite another.
This looks like an act of all-out cyber war.
Like it or not, you earn it all the way.
Yeah, let's see about that, old man.
I didn't do anything wrong. You have to believe me.
Vector me on an intercept, Lieutenant. Have SWAT meet me there.
You promised me defense. In depth.
We found him.
This person needs to believe in the cause.
Came from here?
You said you wanted to start a revolution.
Free everybody.
All the episodes are online at the website 2020.trendmicro.com. I hope this brief look at this 25-page document has been interesting and will spur you to go on and read the whole thing. Thank you very much for listening.